Joining us now for his take on the markets, Jing Candelaria of Philam Asset Management. Hi, Jing. Good morning.
Morning. Good to be back in your program, Mimi.
Great to have you back. So it looks like this market is turning another tough corner, Jing. You know, halfway around the world, analysts like the Citigroup are calling up, up and away for U.S. equities. But it's the opposite story we're seeing here in the Philippines. Our daily cases are at their highest since last year's peak. Vaccines are taking longer than expected, and now new quarantine restrictions are in place. How bad is it going to be for equities this week? We dropped 4% last week, dropped to intraday lows of 6,400. Could 5,000 be closer than we think?
Well, you hit it right, Mimi, that the writing is on the wall. There's no way for the market to go but down, at least for the first half. We're actually in a very deadly combination of slow recovery, rising cases, and slow vaccination. We're practically back to the lockdown last year, except that we have the vaccine that is yet not to be deployed. So the challenge right now for any fund manager is to really try to find the bottom. As you know, performances are being compared, and there's a very big significance on the part of fund manager if they hit it right at the bottom. Last year was quite good. In the fourth quarter, we were able to came up with a 22% run, and all of this turned around. The index target of 7,900 actually became the daily cases of COVID infection that we are having right now. So there will be some painful adjustments with regards to the index target. I think at 6.4, the market is already pricing in the bear price targets for individual stocks. I've done it myself, and I'm looking at 6,200 to be the index for the bear fair value for each individual stocks. Now, is it going to go there or even lower? I believe so with all the negativities.
Wow, okay.
I think two indicators that we need to look into that will determine where the market will go. COVID infection cases, so as long as COVID infection cases registers all-time highs, the market will definitely still go down. Of course, the support to that is the vaccination rate of the government. For now, it's still zero. I wanted to see something significant. I don't know exactly what number that is, but maybe a million per week, which can actually provide us a 20% vaccination rate by the end of the year, would be a good number that could actually stem the drop on the market and possibly provide some confidence again to buy into the Philippine market.
Oh, wow. It's a very gloomy outlook that you have, Jing. But how about this? The Banco Central will meet this Thursday. Do you think there's anything else that Governor Ben Jokno can say or do or telegraph that he hasn't yet to try to calm this market?
Well, the monetary support has always been there and very effective, more than what the fiscal stimulus has done for the country. The 200 basis point cut last year has considered to be one of the most aggressive globally, and it far outweighed, as I said, the fiscal stimulus package, which is about 3.6% of GDP.
Mm-hmm.
But as you know, we're already in a situation where prices are going up. Inflation has come to as much as 4.7%, above the 2 to 4% range of the BSP. And so BSP is in a very difficult situation where its hands are tied to further loosen monetary policy because of the risk that, you know, there will be some a second round effects or spiraling of inflation rate further. Therefore, I believe that the BSP will maintain this Thursday the 2% policy rate. But in itself, that's already a very good messaging to the market that they will be there in times of the difficult situation of the pandemic to support and provide a loose monetary policy.
Okay.
Of course, other tools such as the RRR may not be advisable at this time, as it can further increase inflation.
Okay. Jing, we just want to share the opening numbers. We're 3 minutes into trade. The PSE index opening down. It has been widening losses. Right now, the index is down 1.3%, 83 points. We're at 63.53. You did mention you feel that 6,200 is where fair value is. If you break 6,200, can I ask you where you think the next support could come
from?
The
next support will definitely be the 6,000 level, because that's the level where we started the run in the fourth quarter.
Mm-hmm.
That's where we had a very strong base, and that where it's the level where we catapulted after the reports on COVID vaccine becoming available already globally.
Okay.
So I think investors will be, you know, trying to pick their spots at the 6,000 level. But again, as I mentioned, so as long as COVID numbers and inoculation hasn't been in full force, there will be more downside to the market even below 6,000 level.
But you don't think we're going to retest 4,600, right? I mean, last year we did retest 4,600.
Well, I don't think we're going to go back to 4,600 unless the PSEB closes its doors again and, you know, come up with a trade holiday and create some panic to the market. Then I think that's the only scenario we'll probably go back.
Okay. You know, when you look at the big picture, Jing, given the pressure from our COVID condition, it might be too early to be talking about reflation trade at this point. Where do you see the biggest opportunities to make money off this market?
Well, if I'm going to look at the experience of second and third quarter of last year, where we had the lockdown, and you all know that we're coming in similar to that situation, but not quite, because as I said, there's already vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at the experiences of stocks and sectors which did well from the trough of the market to the third quarter. Market recovered by 28%, and one sector actually outperformed it, and that's the consumer staple sector, where RHI, Eagle, and the URC is there, and they went up by an average of 45%. So if a semblance of lockdown is going to happen again, you know, for the next 2 weeks or further, I think the semblance of citizenry being at the confines of their homes, reducing their discretionary spending and trying to go back into the essentials of buying groceries, cooking at home, you know, buying noodles or coffee.
These are the winners again.
Gold, RHI, and URC.
And Century Pacific, the tuna maker, also was a favorite.
You can add Central Pacific into the mix as well.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay. Jing, I just wanted to share, we have this just in from Moody's Analytics. Just wanted to share with the viewers and you that Moody's says they expect the central bank will opt to preserve ammunition for now, install a rate cut until the next quarter if the domestic situation deteriorates. So basically in line with most expectations that the BSP will be on hold, at least for this week. Let's now go over some interesting corporate stories. First of all, the PSEI is at four-month lows. Lower now, I think, amid new virus curbs. Overseas investors have been selling for 23 straight days, and last Friday they sold the most Philippine stocks in 8 days. How about this one? SM Investments has submitted the notice for tender offer to Togo shareholders at 8 pesos 50 centavos a piece. That's going to start today, March 22, all the way from April 21. Do you think this is a good move by SM to pick up the Togo shares that Dennis Uy just unloaded?
Well, I think as far as SM is concerned, this is a very good vertical integration on their part. You all know there are a lot of SMs all across the archipelago. And so outsourcing the warehousing, the delivery services would probably be more costly on their end. So it would be better for them to just come up with the company. And by doing so, Togo is the best opportunity.
Okay.
So it's both a win-win situation, I think, for both SM and Dennis Uy, as well as, you know, Dennis Uy embarked on a lot of expansion plans, but of course they were hit with the pandemic right now, and therefore they need to improve on their balance sheets at this time.
Okay, Fininvest Land is going to offer up to 1.6 billion common shares of its CyberZone Properties REIT at up to 8 pesos 30 centavos per share. We do know that Double Dragon REIT is going to go public. That's happening this week, same day as the BSP meeting, that's Thursday. Do you think that we can sustain the level of interest in REITs given these new COVID restrictions?
Well, as far as, you know, we insurance companies that offer retail products, we're very much, you know, happy that the REITs market is starting to grow. Mm-hmm. We started out with A-REITs, and then you have Double Dragon, possibly Robinson's is in the pipeline, and, yeah, and we're hoping even SM. Well, it boils down to, you know, dividend yield. As you know, investors are really much very interested in what the dividend yield REITs will offer. We've seen that a sub 5% dividend yield will be frowned by the market, and that happened in A-REITs. It corrected. I don't know exactly what dividend yield is. 8.3 for Fininvest, but for sure this is something that will be supported by the market, considering the clear visibility of where the earnings is coming from. They're basically coming from the rental yields of the buildings, and we've seen that every time that you inject, you know, dividend earning properties into the A-REITs, similar to what A-REITs have done, prices or the benefit of that is being reflected in good prices for the stock. We've seen that A-REITs is one of the better performer for the year. I think they're up 13% and still going up.
Okay. How about this? There's a report that says Petron is set to resume refinery operations within 4 months. They're just waiting for some incentives that they're trying to negotiate with the economic zone authorities in Bataan. This refinery has a capacity for 180,000 barrels per day. Ramon Ang has been saying, you know, these incentives will help, but it's not going to solve the problem, because at the end of the day, we're dealing with low demand, weak demand, and overcapacity that are hurting refinery margins. Pilipinas Shell, the rival of Petron here, has just also closed the refinery. So do you think this is a good move for Petron to reopen the refinery?
Well, so as long as, you know, they can calibrate their cost. I mean, Petron is currently in a very bad situation, in the sense that both the industrial demand, we're coming from a negative 9.5 GDP print for last year.
Yeah.
The worst that we had in our history, and probably one of the worst in the globe. Cars on the consumer side, we can see that work from home actually reduces travel, and so, you know, on the demand side, they're having some difficulties on gaining grounds in terms of their sales.
Mm-hmm.
And another a very bad situation occurring right now for Petron is also prices of oil are starting to rise up again. Came from $20 last year, I think $40 start of the year, and now it's hitting $60. Plus, of course, the fact that, you know, they have a lot of depreciation expense that they need to also plug in, because large capital that they deployed for their refinery 2 project.
Okay. Other stories interesting that we have: Lodestar set to invest in gaming, fintech, and digital entertainment. That seems to be the way to go these days. And for those who missed this, Lushatan Group released earnings for 2020 after trading hours last Friday. For those who missed it, 2020 profit dipped by 9% to just 21 billion pesos. But here's the good news: their tobacco and distilleries business offset weakness in properties and bank. Jing, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about this stock that you like, you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. Why do you like this stock?
Well, under a depressed market, normally the stocks that provide big drops actually gain your attention. But in this case, this is a This is the opposite. Actually, it took my attention because of the fact that it's a stellar performer for the year. Mm-hmm. So the first clue is that for the year, it outperformed or they performed plus 20% versus the market's 10% drop. So that's already a 32% spectacular outperformance.
Okay.
Second, it currently trades at 26 times price to earnings ratio. Seems stretched compared to the 16 times of the market, but definitely it's a growth company. Its fourth quarter profits was actually up 110%, and 2020 profits were actually up 80%. And as we know, the broad market's earnings is down by actually maybe about 50% last year. It's still in a sector where the population is underpenetrated, and they're going into areas of Visayas and Mindanao to offer their products.
Mm-hmm.
It has a very sizable float where foreign long only and hedge funds are actually holding this stock. And lastly, it's a product that very much used by everyone, either for work from home, or if you're the type of person that intends to watch over the weekend, you know, Justice League, Snyder Cut, uninterrupted, then this is a product for you.
Well, okay, now I know your watch list, Jing. But just very quickly, everybody was worried when the share price of this stock, which is a new member of the exchange, fell below its IPO price. And then it recovered. It's now somewhere at 18 pesos, I think. What sort of upside are you seeing in the share price of this stock?
Easily 10% upside to where it is right now.
And over how long? What period of time?
Definitely less than a year.
Okay. On that note, Jing, we're just going to have to guess which stock you're talking about. Jing, thank you so much for joining us. Great to have you back. Looking forward to our next conversation.
Thank you, Mimi.